risk management update, which the sharp eyed amongst you will notice that Bob is saying is one of his great improvements, the development of this work. So welcome. Would you like to take us through the risk management? This is your second guard. This is nice. Is that yet? 2 meters there? Three? Oh, we'll get an old hand then. So there you go.
Thank you, Jeff. This is the third report we've brought. Previous two have been looking in more detail at the corporate risk register, but in light of the time scale between the last meetings, this is more of a general overview of the work that's planned looking ahead and some of the key things going on across the organisation. So, to draw your attention at 3.5, the key piece of work that's going on at the moment is around business planning. Because we've got the new Wirral 2025 plan coming on next month. The work is going on to develop business plans, align directorate risk registers, and ultimately the corporate risk register to that new plan. And we're looking at those risks. And that will tie in with Mark mentioned earlier, and changes to the internal audit planning and keeping that thing as dynamic and fresh. We're also looking at the performance monitoring report in that PSLT and the individuals committee, making sure those risks are monitored closely and giving us that assurance. At 3.8, we're looking at the program management, and again, this was a report brought to the last committee. Around program management for the organisation, and a piece of work has been undertaken to look at the risk management of that stream, ensuring that there's a consistent approach to risk across all of our projects, that risks can be escalated and elevated up the chain, really. Looking at targeted training for the program office managers, and some awareness sessions for different leagues in those areas to again ensure that this is the approach. 3.9, we've got some member subgroup meetings scheduled. We actually had our first one last week with Councillor Green and Councillor Jones in attendance. I appreciate Councillor Gilchrist was unable to attend at short notice. They are programming through the rest of the year. To look at different aspects of risk management across the organisation. The session on last Thursday looked at the corporate risk register and that alignment with the new plan. And so some of those suggestions and recommendations were put to SLT for discussion and then brought back in the next committee. So, again, giving you that assurance, a bit more detail, really. And finally, just around the training for the organisation at 3.12, looking at what as an organisation we need for our staff, whether it's an e-learning package of basic risk management arrangements and practices. There has been one previously, and it's been decommissioned or it's mothballed currently. It was a very generic and a broad approach. Reviewing that and looking at targeting it, particularly for those key areas, but some broad risk management training for staff on what we do in Wirral rather than just basic principles, really. We've also got some work, again, this links in with Mark mentioned work with CCG and coming out of the internal audit report recently. Some focused training with CCG colleagues, we're trying to do it as a joint exercise so we can learn from each other and make sure that we're going along in parallel, really. Unfortunately, events have only taken us slightly. So the first session was supposed to be last week, but as you appreciate, little distractions come into the mix, and that session is cancelled. We have got as much programmed in, but that may be postponed because of things going on.
I'm glad you raised that. It's clearly what you're referencing there, the coronavirus issue. And I notice one of the key parts of your role is continuity. But I think we're all at risk. Now, I would hope if anyone has not been sleeping for a full watch. I suppose the issue now is one of continuity. So what business continuity planning has been going on in terms of how we can make sure that the council continues to function, can operate really?
So we had a meeting last week of a tactical group that's chaired by the Director of Public Health, Judy Webster. I sit on that group and a key part of that was the business continuity arrangements for the organisation. Now, one of the messages I was key to get out to managers and out to staff is, whilst we may have business continuity plans for our critical services, actually this is an unusual circumstance, an unusual scenario. Those plans will not necessarily react fully for this situation. So on Friday day I sent out some requests for information for everyone to reprioritise and re-look at their business continuity planning, understand what their critical activities are, highlight some of the issues that they're going to have, try and scenario plan for different levels of staff absence, because this is a rising tide. It's, as I think Julie said, it's a marathon, not a sprint. So we need to be thinking about the longer term, which is unusual for business continuity instance really. We have got stakeholder and communications coming out. That is a constantly evolving and changing picture. So we rely heavily on public health and public health England and some guidance and following that. They've got strict pathways to follow and comply with. But yeah, the comms for the staff, public and yourselves is going to need mapping up. We've got specialist HR guidance and things coming out as well. So there's a lot of work going on really as we speak.
And can I just follow that up again? I think I have written to someone's put the letter together for me to write based on what the committee said at its last meeting about we were aware that there were a whole series of requests that got out to managers and that they hadn't come back to you. And it was a question of people's compliance with processes and so on. You would hope, would you not, that again people would understand the importance of this and the importance of us knowing at the centre what's that there are plans out there and that they're workable and you know people are talking. So again, has there been any issue in terms of it? Because in normal life one well, I know that's my job, you know, do your business continuity plan. But it needs doing, it had to be done. So, given these circumstances, are you getting the cooperation across the board into, you know, you just need to think things like social services going into our folks, and, you know what I mean? The potential that might have, if some key services, if they weren't visiting people in their homes. You know, these are, if business isn't continuing, some of the things, you know, we need to have plans in place. So, are people cooperating and engaging with you and giving you those returns that suggest that there's realistic planning and we have firm plans to keep continuity going?
So I gave you a very short time scale.
Good.
One size does not fit all, so time does need to be spent, and Mark will know because he's
Super, that's really helpful. It was a really good meeting as well, by the way. I thought we got under the skin of a number of things in the agenda, so I'd be interested to see what comes back SLT on. Has anyone got any questions for Helen? Why just the door first? Carry the damn call, as they say. All right, Helen, thank you for that. Thank you for the work that you're doing. I think, personally, again, it's our last meeting of the year. I found you very helpful to me as the chair in terms of some of the things that are going on. And, you know, I think you've made a real difference very quickly. So, thank you for the work that you've done to support the committee of the year. Thank you. Okay. Right, next one we've got now is the, the spend freeze and known PO known pay compliance, which again has been another area of our interest over the last 12 months. So, Keith, you're going to talk to us about this, are you?
Yes, good evening, Chair, good evening, members. Yes, this is the latest report of the spend freeze and OPO pay compliance. Members will recall that there's been two early reports, one in November and one in January. This report really is in three parts. The first part talks about the spend freeze initiative. The second part talks about the retrospective order situation, and the third part talks about the freestanding invoice situation as well. So if I just start with the spend freeze, Chair. So the first part talks about initial inquiries that we've made with commissioners who have submitted purchase orders. So table one talks about the fact that in this period we've reviewed around about 1,700 purchase orders, which involve around about 131 individuals who created those orders. This tells us that that the amount on these purchase orders was around about 6.1 million. The second table talks
about... Well, sorry, before you drift on to the second table, and again, you won't be surprised. I think the members will be interested in this. First of all, clearly, from what you've said, it's not a freeze. Yeah, I know it's called a spending freeze. Basically, all people have done is review a whole series of purchase orders to see if they were appropriate or not. And then it matched an area where spending was considered to be okay. But, so that's one thing. But the issue for me is, so of these 1,721 purchase orders, and you went back and asked people about them, 67 people answered them in terms of whether, you know, what they were and did they comply. 20 half answered them or something, and 44 people just didn't bother to reply. Can we find out, do we know why 44 people? I mean, we have offered the opportunity for people who don't think the rules apply to them, or they think they're overly bureaucratic, to come to this committee to speak to us and explain why. Don't think anyone's taken that opportunity yet. But do we know why 44 people just haven't bothered? Chair, do you know?
I know the ones in my area, Chair, so if you go to the next table, within minutes, one of them is 15 out of those 44. So I was notified of all of those 15, so I wrote to them individually to say, I've been notified that you've not replied, or you have, so either they're not replied or they're unable to reply. And I asked the question as to why they think that's appropriate, and reminded them that we have got a procedure in place, and that if they continue to not follow that procedure, there will be performance management undertaken or disciplinary action on them. And all of those 15 have responded to me. This is the first time I've sent this email out. There was a bit of a shock there. All of them have responded to me, and they were kind of all valid reasons. So some people were off sick. Some people just hadn't picked the email up, they were late. And then they either had replied after the deadline. There's two occasions
absolutely right, absolutely right. So that was to share. So.
So I've asked them to do that, and all the directors.
Have they complied?
Well, all the directors said that they would. I've not checked back with them. I know that in delivery that has happened because I've had that conversation. I've not specifically asked the others, have you followed up in the same way that I have. So I will do that to make sure that's happened.
Because this is your area, isn't it?
It will be shortly, yes.
Yeah, so we need to, the people need to raise their hands still. Sadly, given the amount of time we've been going on as the budget, but people still need to understand it's not a if you feel like it, don't you? Okay, good. Yeah, away you go, keep going.
Chair, just on that one, can I just point out that this checking process is the second part of the spending freeze initiative. There is a first part, which is all approvers have been informed that there is a spend freeze in place. So even before these rulings get to this point, these approvers have a responsibility to make sure that they approve the orders on a justification basis. So this is really the second part of that. There is an initial part which is where responsibility is placed on approvers.
Yeah, okay. There's nothing quite like a crisis which we're in at the moment for people to say, look, hang the rules a bit, we just need to make sure we've got it down and clean it, or whatever it is. And I think we all understand that we're not like bureaucrats on that, and there will be that. But, you know, broadly speaking, this was pre all the stuff that's gone on, and people should be complying. Yeah? Okay. Bill?
Okay, Chair. I think we've already mentioned Table 2, which is the breakdown of the services within the fund. Table 3 talks about the budget codes which these orders have been charged against. So you'll see the grand total at the bottom of 1,721 orders again. But you'll see on the left hand side a list of the budget codes against which these orders are charged. Table 4 refers basically to the number of orders that were also revised, which were actually retrospective orders. And again, there's some elements in there about whether they the reasons for retrospective orders were administrative, emergency, non-compliance, and
so again, information not provided, £634,000 of council taxpayers' money was spent on 99 orders by 38 people, and they haven't responded. Is that right? Information not provided. Is that?
That's correct. Yes.
Well, any of your department, have you written to them, or are they the same people? Or?
Yeah, they could be the same people. I don't know who these are off the top of my head. Actually, we've not followed up with orders with emails on retrospective purchase orders. We have a bit of trouble getting the information out of the system in terms of the reports, but that is available now, so we can do that now as a matter of course, similar to the email I did before. Yeah, so we will do it.
And can we make sure it's not just you doing it?
Yes. Yeah. Absolutely.
Okay. Excellent. All right. Thank you.
Yeah. I will also put out that as we move into the next part of this report, which is a bit more about retrospective orders,
right,
we are already put some measures in place, as you will be aware, and I'll draw your attention to these.
Okay.
To rectify that as an issue. So so just moving on to section 5, which is the retrospective orders. So the previous reports have reported on the half yearly volumes and the annual volumes associated with retrospective orders. In this report, what I'm trying to focus on are the measures that we put in place and the activity that we've been following. So you can see that you will recall that we provided information about all the training sessions that we did during December and November. We've gone beyond that, and we've actually delivered a number of active workshops directly into the services. So you will see that in 5.3 we can identify all the services that we've been to already, where we've actually had one-to-ones or one with a small team of people where we pointed out the issues around retrospective orders and how to deal with this and how to prevent this in the future. You'll also see that we've got meetings arranged for the 24th and 23rd with the underfloor pavilion and also with some of the sports centres. So we're taking an active part in getting out there and meeting with the services and trying to rectify the problem. Moving on to section 6, which is the no pay, no bill, no pay free staff invoices. So, as in
the sorry, just on that, on the retrospective, can you remember the value of those retrospectives?
Yeah, so in the previous, the last report that we did, which was January, actually, we just gave the numbers in January, but in the November report, we said that the retrospective orders were in the region of 20.7 million.
Water, yeah. That was 20.7, I believe. The free was 29.
Yes, 28 months.
And you lose 49 million.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, there you go.
So, on the free signing invoices, you will obviously be aware of the numbers and the volumes. So we've done some of the pieces of work with this, and in 6.3 we talk about the fact that we've looked at some transactions from law and housing grant transactions. At the moment we feel that it's not possible to raise POs against these invoices. A lot of these things are for things like court fees and barrister charges and so on. So we've taken those off the grant total. In 6.4, we talk about vacancies which currently exist in the payments team. There is a problem here, Chair, and we are concerned that that if we suddenly convert the existing freestanding invoices into PO invoices, then there may be some problems in making those payments actually to our providers. So, so in 6.5 we talk about the fact that the migration of 1,000 invoices, potentially 1,000 invoices, over onto this service may have this negative.
This is Cathy's suggestion to you about 2 meetings ago. Why don't you just take a couple of people and bang through them all?
Yeah.
Remember?
I do recall that, Chair.
So Cathy suggested we should do this at least 2 meetings ago. And now we've got to the stage where, guess what? You know? Are we going to do that or not? This is now on you now, Chair.
So, Chair, I understand that the posts are advertised at the moment. There's some posts which have been advertised, and I think the closing date is something like the 23rd of March. So, we are close to.
Well, 23rd of March is another month away.
No, it's a couple of weeks ago.
2 weeks ago?
That's the two. Yeah.
2 weeks ago.
So, that's the closing date. Cathy was saying this in November. Anyway, yeah, well, yeah. Okay,
so so in 6.6, we do suggest that in order to fulfil these vacant posts, it might take up to 6 months for the impact of this to result in some genuine outcomes, and certainly not in the first 3 months, we think, during the recruitment, just after the recruitment process. That's the dialogue I've had with our colleagues in payments, and that's the response that I've had, Chair.
So, just as a clip, will they be working with you, or will they be with the accounts payable or accounts receivable?
Sorry, do you mean in the future on the
these extra people that you're going to close the advert on the 23rd of March?
So these staff will be accounts payable staff?
Yeah.
Yeah, I can just clarify. So there's two lots of posts we're going to recruit to. So I think the post that Cathy originally talked about was the compliance, looking at compliance. So because we had all these freestanding invoices, we didn't know why people were putting invoices through without a purchase order. So we've got two posts coming in that are short term, that are going to look at all the invoices without a purchase order. the two posts that Keith's talking about is the ones that are in accounts payable, which is in my area, yes.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. Cathy?
The ones that are the done on purchase order and wrong, will these already be paid by the time we start contact the equipment? So you have to determine whether or not they should have been paid or shouldn't, or not you can keep the money as we spoke before, if they've been paid erroneously or twice. The danger is that somebody new, if they're not trained properly, might end up with two invoices going through the same thing, one with PO and one without.
So those that 20, that's 28.9 million that we were talking about in the member report. All those invoices have been authorised. We just not followed the appropriate process. So what will have happened with those invoices is that whoever wants to order goods or services will have asked, can I procure this or can I buy this? The line manager will have said yes or no. If they say yes and the invoice comes in, and then the line manager has to sign off the invoice, they have to physically sign the invoice to say, yeah, it's correct, I approve it for payment. And it's just that the process has not been followed. And that's not a good thing in itself, because this is all the struggle we're trying to rectify. But you're right, what we're actually going to go back and have a look at the invoices that have been paid without purchase order. They've already been paid, they're retrospective. Then we'll go back and challenge people as to why that's happened.
It's in the bit I can't get me out of it. So, I think I need to clarify in my own mind. There's 20 million of retrospective purchase orders, and they will be we paid for the goods without a PO. Yeah, and someone has then scrambled to get the paperwork right, because someone has said, we're not paying this because there's no PO number on it, so we're not going to pay anything if it hasn't got a PO number. So they've been scrambling to do that. And then you've got these, so that's 20 million. Then you've got the further freestanding invoices of 29 million, which makes 49 million. Now, from memory, I think somebody said, well, it says that, but there's the spreadsheet that Children's Services use, so they can follow some sort of process, even though it's on the spreadsheet, and that's about 9 million or something. So when you total it all off, there's £40 million worth of buying stuff that is still not following any sort of, well, not following correct procedures and process, that doesn't have the right checks and balances in place. Is that right, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, Keith?
Almost right, Chair.
Almost, well, sorry, if you want to tell Chair, she was wrong to say, oh, right, then I'll tell you.
Right, because there are sizable volumes of retrospective orders that we get, which are actually set against contracts that we have in place. So although it would appear that there's no process for the payment, there is a background process for the contracts. And so there are some clear examples of this, for example, in our highway services and so on. So it's not entirely true that the 40 million is an unchecked 40 million. There are some background contract processes which kind of facilitate or paint us on a different picture.
Okay. Yeah, of course you can.
So, if there's a contract in place, those without a PO number, are they accurately cross-referenced against the contract? So, if the contract's at 20 million and there's, say, 10 million in PO, invoice without PO numbers, does that bring it down to 10 million off that contract? Are they allocated correctly to the correct contract, even if they haven't got a PO number on?
Yes, Chair, they are. Through the Chair, yes, they are. Yes, they are validated against particular rates that we're supposed to pay, so there is a validation process in place.
Yeah, the issue though, my understanding of a PO is the council officer says, yes, go ahead and do that. Yeah. If there's no, that's what the purchase order says, that's we, as Wirral Borough Council, want some work done. We might have an overarching contract in place, but that doesn't leave the contractor free to do any work. any more questions to Keith? No? Okay. Again, Keith, this has been an area of real interest to this committee. 49 or 40 million pounds of uncontrolled or expenditure without proper controls wrapped around it has got to be an interest to us all, and we really do expect to see a proper level of compliance wrapped around this. So I would hope whatever happens next year, whether it's chair of the committee or whoever makes up the committee, that this is an area of continued focus to make sure that we are maintaining the pressure on this. I don't feel we've made the progress that I was hoping we would be able to make as quickly as I think it needs to be made, but we'll see where we go from next year now. The offer still stands. If anyone thinks the rules don't apply to them or the rules are wrong, well, they just come along and speak to us and we'll listen to what they've got to say. Okay? Good. Perhaps you can compile this for me, shall we? Good, okay, that would be excellent, thank you.
So
a list of people who think the rules don't apply to them and got a better way of doing it.
Yeah, I suppose that's appropriate.
Seekers after truth, humble toilers in the field, Phil. Okay. WFI contract. Cher, are you going to take us through this?
I am, Chair, thank you.
Right.